Namaste, Sri Ranjit Karthikeyan. Thank you very much for being with us today. As you know, the world is in the middle of a crisis. We really don't know when we are going to tide over this particular phase. But definitely, there are discussions around the globe about the implications and the impact of COVID disease over the world order, world economy. Many people suggest that from globalized economy, we are slowly moving towards segmentalized, nationalized economy. Many world leaders are also echoing this particular sentiment. From the Swadeshi point of view, as a representative of Swadeshi Jagran Manch, what is your take on this? How do you perceive the post-COVID phase as far as economy is concerned, as far as world order is concerned?
Definitely there is going to be a turn post-COVID, the post-coronavirus pandemic. Definitely the world has already been talking about what is popularly known as deglobalization. So deglobalization is nothing but what the concept of Swadeshi, that what we were talking about, you know, since 1991. That is Swadeshi 2.0. So basically, if you look at the globe, we have found that the when the global trade was about 5% incremental, the world GDP was 2.5. Now both the world trade as well as the global GDP has pre-COVID has become 2.5 fully incremental. So which means that there has been a decline in it's nothing but sum total of the globe GDP, sum total of the consumption. So basically there has been an era for the last 30-40 years where the powerful economies have in a way kind of manipulated the developing world and possibly utilized their strength, their might through world organizations and twisted all these things to their advantage. Today, the developing countries have realized that and slowly they have been focusing more on their internal economy and this all kinds of free trade agreements, WTO and all these things were utilized for the benefit of the economic powers that rule the world in an economic sense. And that fact has now been laid bare. And the pandemic, the coronavirus was only a reason for that to be coming out in open. Since the inauguration of President Donald Trump, this possibly has been loudly
growing
loudly talked about. And
he has been talking about making America great again.
Exactly. Yeah, right. That's nothing but Swadeshi.
Swadeshi, of course.
And if you look at that particular decision of US to take away the entire manufacturing and outsource it to some other country, China grabbed the opportunity. And we should understand that possibly only a manufacturing can bring in employment. And employment and gainfully employing your citizens is one way of actually growing the economy.
Okay. So you mean to say that this COVID crisis has been a blessing in disguise for developing countries and or a wake-up call? How do you term it?
I wouldn't definitely not call it as a blessing at all, but definitely that was the tipping point, I would possibly like to say. This was a very unfortunate incident to have happened that possibly we call it as a Chinese virus, where China is held responsible by the world countries. And that was a kind of a eye-opener for the whole world, where the supply chains have already been concentrated on one country. The entire disruption happened and suddenly you are sitting where your spare parts doesn't come, your raw material doesn't come, and suddenly you have nothing to do. you are sitting ducks. Here, this pandemic has made people sit down and think, made the world leaders sit down and think.
What went wrong?
And suddenly, the liberalization, globalization, privatization advocates are not seen anymore in the scene. The LPG is not there. So, that is where, in a way, that the pandemic has done something. A slap on the face for the economies of the world to sit down and think that possibly this is the time where you have to relook at your manufacturing.
So it's definitely going to change the world.
Absolutely,
order.
No way it can do really otherwise.
Okay.
There cannot be back to normal kind of situation. There has to be a redefinition. There will certainly be a change and possibly India is in a position where it can give something back to the world and get back to its original position where we started off in the millennia.
We'll come to that. But before that, you called COVID-19 a Chinese virus. I mean, you stressed on the fact that it's Chinese virus. SJM has been on the forefront of criticizing China, attacking China for a long time now. Now, the world is also, in fact, reflecting that sentiment. But still, even today, there are many Chinese supporters even in India. They say that you attack China or China is being singled out for attack because of political reasons rather than economic or Swadeshi sentiments. How do you respond to that?
See, basically, one should understand, China per se has never been a faithful ally, a friend. See, I will have to possibly take you back to 1960. And you know, on the foundation day of the Rashtriya Swayam Sevak Sangh, there is a speech by Param Purujaniya Sarsangh Chalakji. And during the speech in the 1960, Guruji Golwalkar very specifically said that there will be an attack by the Chinese in Ladakh and Arunachal Pradesh. It's recorded, it's there. So everyone rose against him and called him a warmonger. And you know what happened in 1962?
62.
So there is an people who study China know how they react. So right from there, when we were talking about Panchashil and Hindi Chini Bai Bai and all, right from there, it has been cautioned by the erudite, by the knowledgeable people, that you cannot trust Chinese. It's not about the Chinese people per se. No, it's about the Chinese Communist Party.
Communist government.
The government, the party and the government is not different. So when you talk about China, you have to start at least from there, when we got attacked from them. Then if you go further forward, you can see that everywhere they have gone in, they have made sure that they have ruined the economy. And last month, the former NSA of National Security Advisor of Donald Trump wrote a book, Battlegrounds. It got released just very recently.
Okay.
So he has, I have just read about the book. I have not read the book per se, but there was a review on what he has written, the content, in which he has possibly said about the strategy that China is adopting against the world, which is called a neo-colonization.
Neo-colonization,
where, you know, it's a new kind of colonization.
New kind of colonization.
In which he has very detailed written about the three-pronged strategy that China has rolled out very clearly, in which they have said Make in China 2025, where they make sure that the companies that have the technology come to them, they force them with a joint venture, saying that if you only have a joint venture, you will have an access to the the Chinese market, you cannot sell otherwise in the Chinese market. And then this, mostly the businessmen in China are people who are authorized by the Chinese government or the party functionaries. So that is the brief concept about what China, Make in China 2025 is. The number two is the BRI, the Belt and Road Initiative. You know what the name of that project was before? It was called One Belt and One Road Strategy.
Yes, yes, yes.
It was not initiative. Then they found out that strategy is a word which is possibly associated with war and aggression and things like that. They renamed it.
But fortunately, India is out of it.
But I'll come to that. In this BRI initiative, BRI, what they have done is they have gone to every country. And you will be surprised that even countries like Israel have signed in.
It's based on the Silk Route, I think.
Silk Route. And it is the basic reason for the BRI is to increase trade, increase the accessibility to market, spur up the economies and all that glossy terms which will excite any. Just look at what happened to our neighbor, Sri Lanka. In Sri Lanka, they built a huge port when they already had one. This new port, named after the then ruling Prime Minister, President Mahinda Rajapakse, he signed off. He took a huge loan at a high cost, totally not required, and then that was for civil purposes. That was an agreement that there will never be a military use. But you know what happened? I think in 2014 or 16, when the Japanese Prime Minister Abe visited Sri Lanka, there was a Chinese warship submarine
docked there. Japan objected to it.
So then suddenly Sri Lanka was there not able to pay for the loans. They converted it into equity, and then it has a 99-year-old lease. So you have a port inside a strategic location where you are not able to pay 99 years, it is Chinese. So right inside your home, you have
China has a base.
So that is the BRI. Likewise everywhere, Maldives. So when you look at India, if India is affected or not, you have India, the Maldives, you have Sri Lanka, you have Nepal, you have Bangladesh, you have Afghanistan and Pakistan. Pakistan is one place where you talk about…
It's like a colony to Chinese.
You talk about Gilgit-Baltistan and you can possibly say talk about the weather forecast there. But how much more India can do is a big question, because the Belt Road goes through that.
Exactly. But many people say that Modi's foreign policy and foreign trips also, it's also based on countering Chinese strategy.
Definitely. But China has the huge might. The $6 trillion that they have lent, we are still talking about a $5 trillion economy. You know the investments that actually got rotated. The Chinese send their people as workers. They send their equipment. They send their design, consultancy, everything. So the money comes back. And still they have an asset. So the Belt and Road Initiative was a strategic initiative of China to make sure that the neocolonization happens. The debt to equity trap has been very cleverly laid. So that is the second one. And third one is even more dangerous and interesting. The military-civil partnership. The third strategy is the military-civil partnership. They have by law made a decree. They have a law which says that every civil, commercial, individual institutions or individuals will have to definitely give whatever intelligence that they got. So a Chinese company coming in here to India to invest, and many of them have done it. And more out of the 20-25 unicorns that you have, about 17-18 Chinese investments are there. What about technology you're talking? So basically China has used the intelligence also to make sure that, you know, they grab, they actually defraud their investors, they defraud the entire community. And you see the technological leap that they have made in the last so many years. You cannot start from scratch and reach there. So where did the jump start come from? So basically China is not a nation. They have defrauded everybody. The technology they have swindled, they have taken by some unfair means. So that is the second reason. So you have a country which is not at all ethical
and reliable at all.
Number third and the most important, you know, why China? Why against China? Because he is one of the major protector of our enemy. Somebody who sends jihadis into your territory, somebody who tries to create problems to us, somebody who have always made us bleed. And how can you take somebody as a partner when he supports your enemy?
But my question still remains, is it because of the political differences that Swadeshi has with China? Do you think that America is less, duplicity in terms of your relations, in terms of their interference? You see that America is less dangerous?
No, not at all. See, there is one part of the answer. The second part is purely economic. One thing is that, you know, okay, as a citizen, why you should not be trying to protect China or say that they are good, that, you know, you cannot take them to heart. They are not worthy of it. Maybe the Chinese people are good, but the Chinese Communist Party is definitely bad. Now the world knows it. The second is definitely economic. The economic, because you have a huge balance of trade position with China. When you import Chinese products worth about 90 billion or something and send about 6-7 billion to them, that's not on. Definitely that is one reason. They have taken away the employment. You talk about Deepavali, where we celebrate Diwali, where Sivakashi has lost out.
All Chinese crackers.
This thing comes in. They have taken away every single cottage industry, the toys. You go to any park or beach side or anything, you see all this toxic plastic waste.
We have exclusive malls for Chinese goods.
Exactly. And we feel that, you know, paying much less for a product which is bad is great. You go to Japan, you see, when India has a manufacturing contribution of about 3% in the world, where we are about 17-18% of our total population of the world, we make only 3%. Whereas when you go to Japan, they make 96% of what they need.
Such a small country.
Such a small country, where, you know, they have been devastated by the atomic bombing. And they have the resilience to come back and fight and have that kind of a feeling of Swadeshi. So that is economic side of things. The job losses that you have, even small toys, all these manufacturing units are closed. Textiles. So you look at any industry and your dependency, like if the medicines, the raw material, about 70% of the raw material required for drug manufacturing, the bulk drug manufacturing, comes from China. You have something called the API, the activated pharma ingredients. The APIs, you are dependent on China. So it is cheaper to import. So that concept is now gone. Unless you are self-reliant, self-sufficient, there you need even if the cost is not just the factor, your longevity, you know, the long-term policies are to be there. And Swadeshi Jagran Manch always have been rooted on a long-term policy only. There is no knee-jerk, there is no, they write from the WTOs to RCEP.
That's why you are not happy with any government.
See, it's not about being happy, it's about being a kind of a group which will audit, which will see and find out whether this is right for the country or not. It is not about the government, which government sees.
Yes, yes, definitely. I'll come to that. But the picture that you are drawing, I mean, you are presenting now is very frightening about China. But what I am asking is that after this COVID phase is over, I mean, in the post-COVID era, will China face a setback as far as all these long-term policies are concerned? When every government will, you know, try to be self-reliant, and as you said in the beginning, people are having realizations, governments are thinking over it. So will it be a setback for China per se?
See, it's anybody's guess. No, there has been, I don't think that China possibly will just like that close shop or crumble, unless like some other forecasters, predictors say that, you know, it will break up into northern, some breaking up of China like the Soviet Union, that kind of stuff. We don't know, because, you know, see, the
that can happen,
may happen,
because nobody predicted about
exactly
the Soviet Union.
See, yesterday in one of the meetings, Sri Ram Madhavji was mentioning about the number of ports. Now see, you have one of the 20 biggest ports, out of which 11 are owned by Chinese. And if the Chinese are not able to move goods, how are they going to sustain with this? So likewise, the BRI, the Belt and Road Initiative, so whatever they call it, if you think that if there is not going to be that kind of economic transactions happening, crossing borders, definitely China is going to be impacted. Now there has been some videos being circulated in the WhatsApp and social media where they say that, you know, the Chinese factories are getting closed. So basically it's we'll have to watch and wait, you know. But that the point that we stress is not about what China will do, what China will have. That's none of our business.
How we
exactly, our point is, point of reference is how we can have that Swadeshi, back to Swadeshi point of view. I'll have to again go back to history a little bit. It's believed that Gandhiji was probably the founder or, you know, the creator, which is not seriously true. It started in the 1880s or maybe at that time, where the movement has happened, and what Mahatma Gandhi did was that he created a blueprint and gave it to the public.
True.
which was actually again a focus where you are rooted on the ancestral religion. I may not be branded as a secular person when I quote Mahatma Gandhi, who said that he said you have to be rooted on the ancestral religion. It is there for anybody to check. But it's not about the faith. See, faith on which you are, but you have to have a cultural root. Then he said about the institutions, which has indigenous institutions. Then he talked about the third thing is about the economies, the distributed production. So that is the concept of Swadeshi, what Mahatma Gandhi said. Today, during the 90s, when you have the LPG, it dwindled to what import substitution is. All self-sufficiency is. We are not talking about that. We are talking about a very long thing where you have to be rooted on the culture, you have to have your own institutions, and you have to have distributed production where every hands will get employment. Everybody is gainfully employed. The development reaches, percolated down to common man. That is where Swadeshi is. It's nothing to do about the government. We are policy auditors.